IVM.
Welcome to another AMA episode. I feel like every AMA episode that we do of advertising is dead. It is literally a new format we're trying out. This will hopefully stay. I'm going to be joined today by my very interesting stand-up comedian also by night and podcast producer by day, producer Antariksh. Hello, Antariksh. Finally, your voice is on. You've been referred to in many episodes, but you're finally on the show. So we're going to try a slightly different format. I think this might actually be the final one which we try because I think it's going to work. So because, you know, a lot of you send in questions from time to time and the point has been, how do we make sure that the right kind of answers reach you? So we've gotten guests in, we've tried to do it in multiple ways, but I think what we've come down to now is the fact that we're taking a bunch of these questions together, and we're finding either I answer some of them, which I will, but also trying to find different people who are relevant to the questions and kind of answer them. So they're going to be sending in audio notes, we're going to send it in whichever way they can, and we're going to plug that in. So yeah, so this is another AMA episode. This is a Feb 2020 AMA episode, and that's going to be right after this. I'm Varun Duggirala, co-founder and co-chief for The Glitch, and Advertising Is Dead is coming up right after this.
Hey everybody, welcome to another amazing week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you're not following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We'd like to thank our sponsors this week, Paytm Money and HDFC Life. Remember, sponsors make these shows possible. Do show them your appreciation. And if you own a brand or work for a brand or are associated a brand and think that that brand would benefit from working with IVM, do reach out to us. You can find contact information on our website. Also, just a very quick note, I would really appreciate it if you guys could fill out a really short survey on our website. It's on ivmpodcast.com/survey. It's just a brand recognition survey for us to kind of work with the advertisers and give them some data. So it's a very short, less than 1 minute survey. Really appreciate your help in filling it out. So, people, we have a new show releasing this week. It's called Begin the Journey. It's hosted by national award-winning film actor and motivational speaker Ashish Vidyarthi. He shares inspiring stories from various aspects of life. Stay tuned. First episode comes out on Monday, the 2nd of March. This is a bumper week on Paisa Vaisa. We have two very special episodes for you. As part of our regular series, Anupam talks with Suresh Kelly about retirement financial planning. And we have a special bonus episode where Anupam talks to Amit Gupta, who is a portfolio manager at Adroit Financial Solutions, about the SBI Card IPO. On the Filter Coffee podcast, Karthik is joined by the CEO of Wavemaker Polska, Pavel Gala, to talk about the advertising industry. On Simplify, Chuck, Naren and Tony talk about universal basic income. On Geek Fruit, Dinkar and Jishnu are joined by Antariksh, the producer of the show, to talk about the long and illustrious career of Jim Carrey. On Beyond Cliche, Almas is joined by Dr. Sadaf Ulde. She shares her journey of choosing a profession beyond prejudice. On Paperback, the host of Edges and Sledges, Dhananjay Chuck, gets in a conversation with Satyajit and Racheta about his podcast, cricketers, and stories that have stayed with him. On Football Shirtball, Karthik Sivaram and Gaurav talk about Liverpool's losing to Atletico and give their predictions for the second leg of the Champions League. On Golgappa, Tripti is joined by Lakshmi, host of Litnama. They talk about literature, books, and more. On The Traveling Professor's Diary, host Siddharth introduces us to an idea called the Distributed MBA. On GabyCD, Farad and Sunetro talk about long-distance relationships and how it can be or cannot be sustained in this age of Tinder and Hinge. On our Kannada podcast, Thalle Harate, Gautam Shenoy talks about time travel stories, books, and series with Ganesh and Pawan. And with that, let's get you back to your show.
Welcome back to Advertising is Dead. Hi, Antariksh, AMA,
hey,
Feb 2020. So, let's get into the questions. Yep. Question number one
is Deepanjali Singh. Mm-hmm. She sends in Burger King Moldy Burger campaign. Yay or nay?
Okay, first of all, how many of you are planning to eat a burger today? If you are, please do not go watch this campaign. And for those of you who have not seen this campaign, let me explain. Sometimes data insights are great, sometimes maybe not. Burger King had this whole point where people were posting a lot of stuff about how fast food doesn't decompose entirely. So they said, okay, let's prove that we're using natural ingredients. So they put up this image of a burger and then an image of the same burger 34 days later with all the fungus and mold and everything else on it. Yeah. Great insight. Might win them awards, like somebody on LinkedIn posted, but it made me not want to eat burger.
Yeah.
So, nay. I don't think it works. I think it's just makes it, like, it's food. Like, you don't want food to look, ugh. So, yes, nay.
I think you were mentioning on an earlier episode that you expect this campaign to win a lot of awards.
Yeah.
But not really do much for the customers.
It will not win. It will win a lot of awards.
Yeah.
But when you drive by a hoarding, for instance, or when you scroll past a post, the first thing you see is the visual, right?
Yeah.
You're not reading smart copy and seeing the day 34 and all that stuff. You're going to be seeing a moldy burger.
Correct.
So the next time you walk by Burger King, that's the first visual you will have. I remember walking to office and asking Rohit this question, and Rohit literally turned to me and said that, ugh, I cannot get myself to eat any burger. Forget Burger King.
I think that's part of their idea. They want others to also suffer with their campaign.
That is a terrible idea. But although the best response to that though, and a lot of other guys have actually got onto it, is the fact that I saw a post by Nando's where they put up the post from Burger King which says 34 days later, and then next to that put a post of an empty plate and said our burger 3 to 4 minutes later. Which is perfect. That is the perfect response to what this whole thing is. Okay, next question.
Okay, the next question, these are a series of questions sent in by a certain Pratik Satpute.
Pratik has, I think we'll have a limit on how many questions one person can send. Pratik has sent us what?
Yeah.
5 questions. Okay.
There are 5 questions. And I think Pratik is really interested in this space because his questions are very, so only a professional in the space would maybe asking these questions. His first question is, why are digital marketing agencies shutting down who charge very less and do not deliver quality?
Okay. Let's go on.
Okay. Second one is, how to bag good clients with only agency experience and not anything on the portfolio.
Okay.
Next one is the digital marketing space already crowded or we have a lot of space yet?
Hmm.
The second last one is, managing financial aspect while starting an agency today. How do you do that?
Okay.
And the last one is, how to set up an integrated digital marketing agency, finance involved, team building, etc.
Okay, so basically this is an entire playbook of how you set up an agency. Very smart, Pratik. Very, very smart. So, okay. In a nutshell, if I have to kind of put all these things together, there are different things you do at different times in startup agencies. When we started Glitch Off 10 years ago, there weren't enough people doing digital content agencies. That's what we were. Mm-hmm. With that kind of a focus area. So it was great for us. We were one of the first movers. Tougher for us to get work because we had to convince many brands that's what they had to do for the future. That's not a problem most people have today. Now, the whole point is that because there are so many agencies and because everybody doing marketing today is doing digital marketing, right? So the word digital is a tricky word to use because everybody is doing it. So if you want to set up a marketing agency today, what you need to have is a clear differentiator in terms of what kind of quality you're giving, which is why people who don't give quality will shut down.
Yeah.
What you also need to be able to do is figure almost a niche for yourself in terms of the kind of work that you do, right? And then expand into more and more categories. This is my personal perspective, is the fact that right now you need, brands are looking for specialists.
Okay.
And then you grow into having multiple sets of specialists, and then that takes care of everything. Because, and I'll get to the finance and all that stuff later, but the whole point is how do you build almost the fact that there is a market need for a certain kind of agency, and then you build yourself into that and you work with those kind of clients. You might not get the big brands when you start off, right? But find the clients who will give you work to do, build a portfolio out there. But if you have the contacts, go after the guys you can, and sometimes do stuff for free, which we did that and most people do that. And at the end of the day, take it a quarter at a time. See how things are going. Adapt, pivot, keep moving around. You can't make a plan today, to be honest. Nobody ever can. We started off by wanting to be one thing. We changed that every 3 months, 6 months, year. If you asked us 5 years ago, would we be doing what we're doing today? We wouldn't be. And coming to finance?
If I can just ask a follow-up to that. Uh-huh. What would be like an example of a niche that one could target?
I'll give you an example, right? If you're looking at specific areas, look at real estate, for example, right? Okay. I was talking to a couple of guys who run an agency called Insomniacs the other day, and their focus was, they started off as a performance agency, but they built a strong focus area on real estate.
Okay.
And so they build that out as a portfolio, build that revenue stream, then move towards other pieces. That's an interesting way to look at it. In some cases, you are saying, I'm an agency who only focuses on, let's say, the entertainment market, or I'm only doing projects and I'm not going to do retainers. So I'm coming to do flashbang. So you could have multiple things. I mean, you could be an influencer marketing agency, but with a very clear niche. If you look at someone like a Food Talk India, right?
Yeah.
Very focused on the food influencer side, but come back with a marketing solution along with the influencers, right? Yeah. So you have many categories like that. And literally you need to find where you kind of fit in, because everybody's doing marketing now.
Yeah.
It's not just an agency's job, it's everybody's job.
Yeah.
And the finance part, honestly, you need to have someone who's focusing on that. In the early days, it was me, between me and Rohit. I would focus on the finance and operations side of things. Rohit would focus on creative. I still do a bunch of work on the operations side, but you need to have an eye on that, because at the end of the day, you're a business, which means you need to make money. And if you're only focusing on the fun stuff, which is the creative work, then that'll suffer. So yeah, I've also asked Harshal from Shebang to kind of give his response, and I think we should listen to what he has to say.
So for anyone starting a digital agency today, I think that A, the digital landscape is quite vast. So choose a specific area that you will be excellent at. You know, is it going to be performance marketing? Is it going to be performance marketing creatives? Because that's a big void. Is it going to be, you know, certain owner-led businesses? Because not all agencies are able to serve those. Is it going to be a focus on small and medium businesses? Is it going to be a focus on large businesses? So I think, very importantly, find your focus and really shout out off the rooftops what that focus is. And then I think get obsessed about, you know, if the area that you're focusing on, what are the current gaps in that focus? So really just pinpoint, if you're focusing on owner-led businesses, pinpoint what owner-led businesses have irritations with in the way they're currently being served. So I think the more you understand that, the more you will be able to shape your pitch narrative, the more you will be able to attract those kind of businesses, because they'll resonate and they'll say, yeah, this guy gets me. Yeah, so I think once you shape that and you define that, getting clients then is very, very easy. To summarize, I would say just focus and focus on a particular space to start with, and then obsess about that customer and obsess about how you're going to fix things for that customer. I think then talent and quality of work becomes a function of that, because then you will very clearly attract a certain kind of talent to fit for that problem, and the quality of work that you will be working on will be fitting for that problem. So as long as you're fitting for a certain problem and you're solving something, then you know you're bound to stay for many, many years. So I know that second part is a little esoteric, but it truly is that you know, I mean, it's not a one size fits all answer, because if you're doing a performance focused business, then the managing talent will be about the kind of, you know, about ensuring that your people are doing the work that is more performance oriented. If you're doing owner-led businesses, you're managing talent, which will be in essence people who are working with owners as, you know, their right hands. And quality of work then will be a function of how well that owner sees the work received. Yeah, but I think in general, people come to work, and we said this on the, you know, Varun and I spoke about this on the podcast as well. But we spoke about the fact that people come to work to do excellent work. So once you've defined what your definition of excellent work is, then you pull just that talent who will be interested in doing that excellent work, and that talent will then stay. So I think that's where I would leave it.
Yeah.
Okay, moving on to the next question sent in by Ritik Gupta. He asks, thanks for doing these AMA. Really admire your podcast. My question is, what can AI do in the field of advertising except data analysis?
So the thing with AI is, right, most times you look at it as something that will analyze data. And while that's a large part of it, what is the biggest trend in advertising, and especially content in advertising, is the fact that automating a lot of the creation process. So while the core creative will never be fully, in my mind, data-driven or automated.
Okay.
Let's say that you make one creative for Facebook, right? To adapt it to multiple platforms, where, like, you know, the sizing you'll have on Instagram versus what you'll have on, let's say, Snapchat versus what you'll have on a TikTok are all different, right? Dimensions are different. So you generally have a designer manually doing those things, versus using something like a Canva, which is a great app to use. Yeah. It auto adapts it. Right. So that's a great way to look at how AI is really being able to do things. It figures out where the text needs to be, for instance, how do you auto adapt it? So humans' jobs become easier by using automation and AI. And I think that's really the core part of where it's going to be. And it might even help finance. There's this new Microsoft Office app that I've been using, which lets you draw out a table. And if you scan it from your phone, it makes it an Excel sheet. Which technically takes the finance person's job and makes it easier. So I think making our lives easier and taking away the mundane stuff is where AI will really come in.
But it'll never be take over the entire space.
The core creative idea will always be human is what I feel. If that happens, then why are we around? then it's like Judgment Day. to anybody who's in Terminator.
Okay, fair enough.
All right, guys, moving on to the next question. Sent in by Cash on Delivery. That is, the person's name is Akash. It's 2020. The internet has seen everything. How do you keep it fresh?
Okay, it's actually an important question, right? But I don't think it's only about the internet, to be honest. At most times, even before the internet, there's nothing called an original idea. People have seen most things. So for someone to claim they have an original idea is them not really understanding how the world works. Mm. Everything has a frame of reference, right?
Yeah.
But if you really want to keep it fresh, you need to keep getting fresher minds in play. If the same people are coming up with creatives on something all the time, you at some point are going to hit a deadlock. But the more people you kind of bring into, not just brainstorm, but actually come up with the ideas themselves. And that's where I would say the generational handover needs to happen.
Yeah.
Like if you ask me today to come up with content for TikTok, I might not be able to. But during my time, if you ask me to make something for, let's say, a Facebook, I could. And that's really how the transition happens. Fresher minds, where the older ones are actually helping build structure, while people who are kind of coming in are building fresher ideas because they're fresher consumers, right?
Yeah. Okay.
And that's really how you keep it fresh.
Yeah.
Another person who I wanted to ask this question to was Ashwin Suresh from Pocket Aces.
Yeah.
Primarily because Filter Copy being one of the, like, I think it was the most followed Instagram account in 2019, beating a lot of people like Virat, etc.
Okay.
So I think it's very relevant for him to answer this because they seem to be doing something right and keeping it fresh.
Okay.
So yeah, so Ashwin sent in a response. I think we should listen to that.
Before the internet had seen everything, I think television had seen everything. Everything is a version of something else. So, you know, keeping content fresh is not really challenging because what we do anyway is because we have so much distribution and because we're always communicating with our consumers and our audience, we just keep looking for insights from there. We talk to them, we ask them what they like, we ask them why they like something, we monitor trends, we monitor kind of things that are happening around the world and on the internet especially. And then we find unique ways of providing takes on that, right? So we are ultimately a voice. We're kind of a medium of expression. And what is fresh about it is actually the take that we provide on it. It's not necessarily the underlying event or the underlying content. So I think, you know, it's not challenging to keep things fresh. I think, you know, audiences are evolving and the internet, we think of it as this big monolith, but it's not, right? It's hundreds of millions of people. There are newer and newer people coming on the internet every day. There are, you know, people who are entering their teens for the first time. There are people who are exiting their teens for the first time. There are young adults who are becoming young adults for the first time. And so for each of those kind of demographics, there are new experiences you can provide. We see this in our content. You know, we see that when we do a piece of content, let's say, you know, some of the stuff we did back in 2016, say Little Things, right? Very popular show for us. On Dice Media, and there are audiences today that are entering college that are consuming Little Things for the first time, and they're going through that same journey, and they're going through that experience, and they love that experience. So, you know, fresh is relative. Fresh is kind of a very difficult to understand term, and I think that to keep something fresh, it needs to be relevant to that demographic, needs to be kind of fresh for that audience. So I know I've used the word fresh and relevant and content and audience a lot, but that's kind of broadly my views on it. The answer simply lies in just talking to your consumers.
Okay, moving on to the next question, guys. Sent in by Lord Kurt Morris.
Kurt Morris is one of our most, and this is one piece of trivia. Whenever I post anything about any of our episodes, Lord Kurt Morris will respond. He will say good things, he will share it. So I would say thank you, Lord Kurt Morris. We are all very happy that you follow our podcast.
Yeah,
he's an IVM listener since 2015.
Very cool. Okay, Kurt Morris asks, do you think magazines will have their space in the content marketplace in the future?
Do you read magazines?
Not anymore, I don't think.
So I might be one of the few people who I think still subscribes and reads magazines, not physical form though. I read them on my iPad, but I think magazines will always stay, right? Magazines, at the end of the day, are content companies, right? And they have very core focus areas in terms of their area of specialty. Most of them globally and as well, and I would still say in India as well, have started building out almost like content teams to kind of work with multiple platforms, work with brands to kind of almost like create focused content, right? Even if you look at something like if you look at a digital magazine per se, if you look at even someone like a Condé Nast, right? If you look at what they've been able to do with everything from Vogue to GQ to kind of create properties that go into awards, go into TV shows, go into everything else, that's the way they'll survive.
Yeah.
While the magazine pretty much will always be there for the sake of being there. Mm. But I think the real revenue for them and the real growth for them will be across different things. Yeah. I also feel that the ones who don't evolve in that space will not survive, right? So it needs to work almost as a group, but it's trickier for individual magazines to survive. And especially in cases where, you know, a magazine comes out and if it's talking about something that happened today, it means that it was printed, let's say, a couple of days ago. Whereas you in the time of the internet, right? What is today is right now. And I think that's really the problem. The ones who are more current and in that space kind of will face, which is why I thought it'd be interesting to also ask someone who started off a digital publication of sorts. So I reached out to Ravina Rawal from Dead Ant. She's been on the print side and she's also moved to the digital side and set up her own online publication.
Yeah.
So I thought it'd be interesting to get her perspective. And this is what she had to say.
I do feel that magazines will continue to have their space in the future, especially for niche interests. The market for generic publications seems to be saturated, but niche independent publications are still springing up all over the place, like Dead Ant for stand-up comedy, for example, or what music or travel, sports, cars, that sort of thing. There is, in the cultural spaces, there is an argument for how we don't need gatekeepers anymore, because in so many ways, you know, everyone is now a publisher or a critic or their own curators. But with so much information coming at you all the time, I believe that there will always be a need for some sort of streamlining and, you know, to have dedicated spaces where new ideas can be explored and these conversations can be nurtured. I also find increasingly that people are looking for voices that they trust to tell them how to think or feel about things. Because, you know, again, there's so much information coming at you all day, every day, from every corner about everything, that we don't have the time or the patience to pause long enough to put our own thoughts together about how we feel about something. So as a publication, you're not just playing platform, but also sort of adding value by offering an argument or new perspectives, or saying, you know, hey, here's a thought that may not have occurred to you yet about this. Let's discuss. Now, how you package a magazine is open to, or what you call or define a magazine as, is open to both debate and experimentation. I do feel it has to be multi-platform, multi-format, because you need to get to people, you need to reach people in whatever way that they are consuming things at that time. So if you have a great story but you only want to write a long form piece about it and your target audience isn't into reading, then that's a waste. So package it in a way that allows your stories to be told and for them to travel. Now, is that a physical magazine or is it online? Is it a written piece? Is it a video? Is it an Instagram story, a meme, WhatsApp blast even? And then, of course, is that still called a magazine or not?
All right, let's move on to the next one.
Yeah.
Abrar Nakhuda sends in. You mentioned in your earlier podcasts that you look at some of the agencies in the West and try to adapt what would be adequate for your own. So, which are some of the agencies one should keep their eyes on? Also, when do Pooja, you and Rohit start planning and implementing a new service or strategy for the company? And what is the process slash checkpoints like?
Okay, it's actually a very interesting question, right? Because I have this tendency to stalk most global agencies, and I use the word stalk because they're constantly... I have this one browser window open which has all the tabs of all agencies which I like. And wow. I keep seeing what they do. It's yeah. it's nice to look at it. So agencies I admire are... So Drogafy, just generally because they understand culture so well. I look at work that is done by... What else do I look at? Wyden and Kennedy. I look at work... which some of the smaller agencies, but who actually had very interesting work. So there's an agency called Swift, which is a WPP agency based out of Portland. And they've had a very interesting social... agency journey, and I find their work very interesting to look at. I look at a lot of the content production agencies. So Media Monks is a great example in terms of just generally building production up to scale. And just also, it's not just an old favorite actually is RGA, which is against. And my whole point of looking at them is not to see, oh, I actually seldom look at their work. I look at how they present their work. I look at how they structure their services. That's almost like a personal peeve. I like to see how everyone's kind of building a different narrative around what the agency stands for and how they present their services, how they're evolving those, how people are going into spaces like consulting and production and prototyping for startups and et cetera. So those are things which I kind of look at. And to go to the second part of it, when we actually start planning, and it used to be a time when only the three of us would sit and plan this out. Now it's actually our entire leadership team. We do roundups with our leadership team. People propose things that we should be bringing in as services. Many times we end up trying to sell a lot of stuff which are not yet our services, but because someone came up with the idea of actually going to a client and saying, this is a great opportunity, this is something you should do, or this is something that we can do. It just happens, and we figure out that, okay, fine, one second, this seems to be working. Can we almost structure it into a service? And the whole point of a service, and we realized that very early on, was that it's not about, oh, let's go out and sell something new in the market. It's about saying, if we almost put it into a certain box per se, you're then giving one individual within our leadership ownership of that box and saying, okay, fine, now you are driving this. You're kind of building out almost a strategy behind how we go to clients, to platforms, to everybody else, kind of help and sell this, right? So that's really how we look at it. It used to be a yearly thing. Then now it's an always-on thing, right? People come up with stuff all the time. Yeah, and so that's how we do it.
And are clients, potential clients, always ready to listen to such a proposal?
So the thing is, it's generally something we actually go to clients whom we already have.
Okay.
Because we turn to them and like...
Because they already trust you already.
Like, right? I've had a conversation like this today morning. I was in a meeting, right? Finished the meeting, came out, sat to the client saying, okay, this is something we should thinking of bringing out into the market. Something that we think will be good for you to kind of utilize.
Yeah.
What's your point of view on it, right? It's important to kind of ask clients who have worked with you for some time, right, who you have a relationship with, saying, this is what I think might work. Do you think it'll work? And sometimes they may say, no, it won't. Or sometimes they'll give you a point of view about saying, okay, no, this is how you should do it so that it actually, you know, it'll make more sense for brands like us, right? So kind of get that feedback. Don't just sit in your office and do it, is how we look at it.
Great. Moving on to the next one.
Oh, next one's a lot of questions in one.
Yeah, a lot of questions because they're similar in theme, the Perfect. Questions. We'll just read all of them.
And yeah, let's go all of them.
The first one is sent in by Arshil M. Badia, or he says, is an MBA necessary to excel in this space? Do support it with why?
No, but I will get to that
okay.
later.
Next one is, being in a job and switching to creative field, how to do the transition?
Okay.
The next one is, the last one was sent in by Bizarre 910 Soul. The next one is sent in by Pavitra Rajesh. She says, how do I judge whether I'm creative enough to do a copyright? To be a copyright or even in the content creation field in general. Hmm. On what basis do you hire writers?
Okay.
Next one is Zahar Alak asks, what, according to you, are some must-have skills for someone entering the field of advertising? The last one is sent in by Tanuj Mittalji, who says, how to find the right talent for an agency?
Okay. Just kind of summing up, right? Talent is one of the... When someone says, what business are you in? What is your core asset? Most times, I mean, most of us who run creative companies turn around and say it's our talent, right? And to find the right kind of talent, and I'll get to that one first, is the fact that you need to, A, not just look at the kind of brands you have and what they require, which is very important. Sometimes you might have a great person you find, but you might not have a brand who they would fit into. And then you need to gauge, are you going after brands which will be good for them? Because that's what makes it good, right? But literally, to find good talent right now is to pretty much keep looking all the time. Be open to looking at people who are not just from an advertising background, who are not just from an MBA background, someone who's switching from an area of expertise. And someone said that, let's say someone's working in journalism, which means they know how to write.
That's true.
Which means they might actually be very good for long form pieces that you're writing out for brands. Or let's say there's someone. So everybody has learnings. And no matter what you've done in your early career, whatever you've studied, those learnings can be applied in a certain certain way into a job in advertising. What is also important is, if you want to be a writer, then just write. So even if you don't necessarily have actual work you put out there, you can still showcase some pieces that you almost put together as your portfolio. So we've had people who applied to us who've never put anything out from a brand perspective, right? But say, this is my portfolio, this is the kind of stuff I've written. We generally send them writing tests.
Okay.
So we basically give people a brief and we asked him to either come back, if it's a strategy role, come with a presentation of how we would do this, if it's a writing role, come back with a script or come back with copy, come back with, you know, and kind of make them do it within a time limit of, let's say, a day or like a couple of hours. And so, that also shows how they will actually do it. If it's design, come back with design. So, that's really the most important part. You need to have an understanding of how to work with brands. But also more importantly, you should have some sort of a skill set which you can then expand in advertising, right? But my most crucial thing, because I generally do a fewer interviews now than I've done over the years, but what I kind of look for is someone who really wants to do a lot. If you kind of have that hunger to do more pieces, kind of expand your mind and come in with fresher ideas, that's really what I personally look for. I look for a vibe in a person, and vibe doesn't mean that you need to get cool people in an office. Cool people aren't the most creative people. Creative people are the most creative people, and everybody is creative. So that's the way I look at it. People generally try to hire cool people, but not all cool people are great people to have in an organization.
I think all of that should be on a t-shirt.
Yes, not all cool people.
Yeah, not all good. Okay, moving on to the next question sent in by Ian Smith, who asks, what is creativity? What forms of creative expression is essential to be a successful ad man?
Okay, the one person I know who will answer this the best is Roshan, as in Roshan Abbas. So we'll definitely plug in an answer from him. But what is creativity to me? Creativity for me is something which we all have. It's just that we need to find the right way to express it. When you make something out of nothing, that's creativity. And I don't know if that makes sense, but basically, if you look at something mundane or something that is static and you imagining stuff around it, or you kind of building something on top of it, and creativity is not just like, let's say, design or copy or anything like that. Creativity is someone who codes, could be someone who's just creating, let's say, the artwork. Artwork's again a weird example, but I would say tech for me is almost creative fields. And I keep looking at people who are building games, who are building, who are literally building out what is the next form of expression out, be it AR, be it VR. Someone who makes a Snapchat filter, right? For me is creative. And I think it's important for people to understand the different ways in which you can express your creativity. And that's what makes you a very good, I don't like the term ad man, but that's what makes you a good creative person. Also what's important to have a pulse on what is culture today. And what could culture be tomorrow, to kind of have a pulse on that, to not, like, someone who cracks a Sholay joke today to me is not culturally relevant, right? Because I don't know how many people have watched Sholay in recent.
Trump just talked about it. He said DDLJ and
exactly Sholay. Why he's not relevant. Trump is a, anyway. Oh no, I don't want to go down that rabbit hole, okay, but right. Anyway, I think we should plug in Roshan's answer as well. I'm sure his answer will be far more interesting than what mine was.
What is creativity? Creativity, as one of my favorite quotes always was, is intelligence having fun. But it's so many different things. Creativity is taking two or more than two multiple diverse things and putting them together to create something new, to make something new. Whether that is towards getting people to connect with you, whether it solves a problem, whether it entertains, whether it educates. It could have many, many reasons where you use that creativity, but essentially putting diverse things and coming out with something new is what I find is the core of creativity. Many people feel that creativity is something people are born with. I don't agree. I really feel that over a period of time, you can learn certain aspects of how to be more creative. Your degree of creativity can be your natural talent, but yes, I do think that, innately people who are able to look at diverse things and put a new spin on them are at their core creative people. Now, what kind of creative expression is needed for someone to be in our industry or in an agency? Firstly, you must be able to express yourself. Unfortunately, we live in a world jahan par jo dikhta hai, wo bikta hai. So if it's going to stay in your head and you can't put it into any format, and I'm not saying words, you could put it into a sketch, you could put it to music, you could make it into a poem, whatever it is. But that form is something you must have. If you don't have that form, very often in the olden days of advertising, you would always find a copy guy working with a person who was a design person. And that became the essential idea in the early days. But now, more than ever, I find that a bunch of people work together. So you'll have somebody who is a UI UX person working with someone who understands at the core some other aspect of creativity. Many agencies put together teams which come together, coalesce, and there's one person leading them to bring out a final form that would appeal to either the client or to the consumer. I feel that don't try to change your creative expression. If you're a writer, stay true to that. If you're a person who sketches or paints or draws or does 3D or whatever or makes memes, so be it. But if you can't express yourself, which sometimes there is a set of creative people I've seen who are not very good communicators, but when they put things down, it is gorgeous and fabulous. Find somebody who can do this for you. It'll pay you rich dividends in the future. My final fact is that, you know, if you really want to be creative, because maybe hidden behind your question is that fact as well, try and find diverse influences. Don't browse, deep dive. Do not take your first draft as your final draft. Read, write, reduce, repeat. Do that as a process. Ask for feedback. Go on a creative date. Do something scary. I often do some crazy things just because I'm intrigued by them. I follow through very deeply, and I know I'm making this a little personal, but I feel that it might be something that'll help. Because creativity creates virtuous circles. You'll find one influence here, another influence maybe in a song, a third influence in something you read, a fourth influence in food, a fifth influence in a digital piece, and all that would coalesce in your mind and come out as your own unique creative expression.
All right. Next one is sent in by Pranjal Bucha, who asks, what are the books that you would recommend for students who want to get into advertising?
Okay. It's an interesting one. So I have this terrible problem with books, right? I seldom finish books, but I'm always trying to read anything between 3 to 4 books. Some I finish.
Okay.
So I'll maybe pick a few which I feel were relevant, which I found interesting in this entire thing. So one book, if you actually want to understand how the advertising space has really evolved, there is a book called Frenemies. You know, like friends who are enemies, frenemies. So this is actually a guy. This is almost to show how this entire industry has been disrupted.
Mm.
So it kind of showcases points of view of how the traditional agencies have functioned, how that entire, you know, how different parties are going to come in and take in parts of that pie across, how almost it's been a paradigm shift over the last decade, right, of how things have really changed.
Mm.
And this is an eye-opener because you also, it gives you a great understanding of the dynamics of the industry, right, which it's great. It's actually a good read also because it reads almost like a pot boiler as well because there are different people, different these things there. Another book which I thought was interesting is called The Content Trap. By Bharat Anand. It's interesting from primarily looking at it from a strategist lens of things.
Mm-hmm.
Again, really, really interesting to kind of read and understand, not just from a strategist lens, but also like data and how we look at content and how we look at all those pieces.
Yeah.
Please read Piyush Pandey's book. It's a great read because it just generally gives you perspective. It's called Pandemonium. Great examples, great stories from the entire journey of his. Always a good thing to read. Everybody says read Ogilvy on advertising, so read it. I've read it as well. You will get a lot of insights on it, but again, it's one of those standard things you will read anyway. So I wouldn't say it's almost something which everybody will tell you, so I will not push it, but I'm sure you will read it anyway. And let me see if I can pick out one last one. This is me trying to act like I am thinking about it while I'm scrolling through my entire Kindle app and trying to find things to talk about. Actually, instead of reading, I think just go on YouTube and watch everything that Scott Galloway says.
Okay.
Scott Galloway is this professor from NYU,
yeah,
who also co-hosts a podcast called Pivot. He has many videos out there on the advertising industry about how this entire space has evolved.
Yeah.
Those videos have taught me a lot about just perspective or how to look at this entire space. And I think that's something we should watch more than reading. So those are my picks.
Very nice.
Please let me know if you guys read anything else, which you thought was more relevant for this. Okay. That was me asking you guys a question.
But also, like, are you, you're not always reading just advertising books. You read a lot of other stuff also, right?
Yeah, yeah.
You should always be reading multiple.
So I actually find the other stuff a lot more interesting, right? So recent reads were like Ride of a Lifetime, which is Bob Iger, the Disney CEO's autobiography. Phenomenal book. I've read it like one and a half times. I'm reading it second time right now. There's a book called The Hard Thing About Hard Things. Again, great about somebody who's going through an entrepreneurial journey. It's very interesting. Also because Ben Horowitz, who wrote it, was one of the founders of Netscape. And then, so he has some very interesting perspectives on failure, which is very important to kind of learn. And recently what I started reading, actually, no, there are two more books, right? One was called called The Trillion Dollar Coach. About this guy whose name is, let me tell you, Bill Campbell, right? And he was the coach to most of the big, of most of the visionaries you know from the tech industry, right? Everybody from Steve Jobs, Satya Nadella, Sundar Pichai, Larry Page, to name a few, if not more. And he's been one of those guys who's almost been an executive coach to them. So he, it's his process that's spoken about. Again, great book to read. And last one, which I just started reading, it's called Who is Michael Ovitz? Michael Ovitz started CAA, which is one of the world's largest talent management agencies. Great insight into Hollywood and how that whole talent space evolved. So, yeah, lot of book recommendations.
Very cool. Get on those, guys. We move on to the next question. Next question is sent in by Rohan Desai 92, who asks, how will the role of content evolve in an increasingly performance and ROI-driven world?
So, this is the thing about content in the digital space, right? Most of the things you kind of put out today, you know if it worked or if it didn't work immediately or through a quick span of time. And so what becomes important is to gauge how much you invest into a piece of content beforehand, because and it's important to then kind of put down things about what you really want to get out of it. So when you say ROI and performance driven, that those are actually good things, right? You're looking at something and saying, okay, one second, like a social media post. You're putting something out there, you might not want to promote it as a brand, which means you're not putting any media money behind it, which means do you necessarily need to spend as much money on it as you would on something that you would put media money behind it at? Because how many people are going to see it organically versus how many people are not going to see it? And I think that's really crucial to look at. So you need to set why you're creating a piece of content first before you even get into creating it. You then need to move into the fact that with performance, what really comes in, and performance marketing is actually, you know, the drivers of the whole startup ecosystem, right, of e-com in that sense, is that you're really pushing out different kind of content assets and creative assets to consumers to kind of see what they react to, and then you're constantly evolving it. And which means it's an always-on activity, makes it very sharp. And I think that's great ROI, right? And when you focus on something which is sharp and ROI-driven, you're actually coming up with more innovation. Because if everybody had the kind of money they want to have to build content, then we would all do it, right? But in most cases, we it is for businesses. And I think the role of content today is to be more responsible, to know what you're creating it for, and not just because as an individual you feel this is a great idea to do. Because then it's not necessarily a brand-focused content piece. Then it's something which you necessarily want to make. Find the money to make it. Find someone to fund it. But if you are creating it for a brand, it needs to have a clear set of almost target areas you want to hit and what it needs to achieve. And then you gauge if it's achieved those and you evolve it from there, is the way I see it.
All right. Moving on to the last question.
Okay.
Sent in by Sarcasm.
Okay.
During this entire podcasting journey, what is the one thing which changed within you?
The one thing, and it's actually a great thing, which has changed within me, is that I've, after a long time, put my creator lens back on. Because when you're running a business for a long time, you start to lose that lens and lose the way you enjoy doing that. I put that lens back on, and it's really been a revelation, because I look at things in a slightly different way. I don't look the jugaadness of things sometimes leaves you as businesses you create get larger. But this kind of brought back that whole creative juices started running a lot faster. And I also look at things from a very, how to put it? When someone's shooting a video today, for instance, or wants to create a piece of content, I look at it from, oh, how would I do it as a creator versus how would I do it as an agency? And many times the agency perspective and the creator perspective are different, and the idea now is kind of seeing how can I bring those two together and find that middle ground of where it can actually be a successful merging of two ways of thinking, because there should be a merging of that for any agency to survive. The other thing that's really been interesting is the fact that I also started being a lot more open about experiences. While I've always been a chatterbox who will speak throughout the day, I think I'm also being open about stuff that I've been through, stuff that I'm going through, perspectives that I have, and kind of putting that point of view across. That's actually what's changed. It's been one of the best things ever.
Also, I think it's very nice that you do these AMAs, because people need to know this. They don't need to know all this stuff.
Because you know, and it's interesting you're saying this, right? Because what's actually happened is over the last, 66th episode, 65-odd episodes, what's really happened is the fact that many times people ask me questions and I respond to them individually on social media.
Yeah.
And many times after I respond to them, I think about the fact, oh, this answer could have actually been relevant to maybe 50 more people or 30 more people or 100 more people. The more and more I think about it, it's important to kind of put this out.
Exactly.
So while it doesn't sound like a regular episode, what I think will be interesting is the fact that a lot of these answers cater to a lot of people. So I think the AMAs should be fun. We could continue doing this. I think people should give us more feedback on how this worked, didn't work. And I think that's a wrap for this episode. I think AMAs need to be short. So if you go on for 1 hour with questions, people will fall asleep. It will feel like an exam hall. So that's it for this episode of Advertising is Dead. We'll be back to normal service from next week onwards. Yep. So please tune in. And bye.
Hi, my name is Anupam Gupta. I'm B50 on Twitter. I am the host of Paisa Paisa, the show that talks money. On my show, I speak to experts from every field of money and finance, from stock markets, equities, debt funds, credit cards, life insurance, every possible area of money and finance that you can think of. We even did an episode on cryptocurrency. I've got fantastic guests from mutual funds to personal finance experts everywhere, robo-advisory, startups, just name it, we've got it. At Paisa Paisa, we help you make smart decisions about money. You work hard for money. Now make your money work hard for you. New episodes out every Monday, and you can listen to my show on the IVM podcast app or any other podcasting app that you have. Paisa Paisa is brought to you by Paytm Money.
How does one separate news from opinion? I'm Mahrukh Inayat, a news junkie, but not a big fan of debates. I love facts, and I like to stick to them. No frills, just pure analysis. This election season, is Balakot a game changer for 2019? Did Priyanka Gandhi Vadra join politics too late? The Chowkidar Wars, who's really winning? I will cut the clutter and analyze the stories that matter to you.
You can listen to the show on the IVM Podcasts app or wherever you get your podcasts.